When it comes to building a race car or a drift car, there's more to it than just getting the performance out of the car. And building a car that's got both form and function, in our opinion, is really important to focus on. And no one does that much better than Carl Thompson. We've previously featured his quad-rotor turbo Toyota Aristo drift car. However, Carl sold that car off some time ago now to focus on his new challenge, which is this S15 drift car behind me. So, Carl, let's start by talking about the elephant in the room. You were a rotary guy. This has definitely not got a quad rotor in it. You've swapped to a Mass Motorsport LS based engine. So can you tell us why you went away from the rotary?
I think it was the biggest thing for me was mainly the parts, you know, sourcing the parts. If, you know, there's only one guy making cranks for rotaries, whereas there's 10, 20, 30 making them for V8. So it was mainly a off the shelf thing, and also quality control, you know, knowing what you're buying, getting the best stuff, and you know, if someone says that it'll be there in 2 weeks, it'll be there in 2 weeks.
Yeah, I think
that's what did it for me. Yeah,
I think that's really important. I mean, it's one thing making the power, and there's no doubt that your quad rotor turbo engine was making
it
the power.
It was ridiculous. Yeah,
but the quad rotor was never an off the shelf motor. You can't get the parts, as you're saying,
yeah.
And particularly if you want to be competitive in any form of motor racing, you need to go to races, go to rounds, and be competitive.
Yep.
And to do that, you obviously need the engine going. So the LS market, both in the US here as well as around the world, is really, really busy. Lots of companies making some amazing parts. So let's talk about the engine combination you're running. Can you talk us through what you've got
sure,
in there?
Sure. So this one here is a GM block, so it's cast iron.
So this is the LSX block?
Yes, LSX, yep. It's 450 cubes, so it's got a 4 1/8 stroke in it, 14 to 1 compression, and we run the Mass Moses head, which is a canted valve head, tunnel ram and stuff as well, yeah.
So just tell us briefly, we'll come back to this, but tell us briefly at the moment, how much power is it producing?
It's about 825 at the tyre on my main line. So, and that's not pushing timing, and it's on C16, so it's not really obviously the best gas for it.
All right, so I think the first thing the LS lovers out there watching this are going to be asking is, why the necessity to go to an LSX cast block when there's various examples of people pushing that sort of power, if not more, maybe with turbo applications on the stock alloy block?
Reliability. You know, obviously everyone has their own thought train, and I can't knock that, but for me personally, I've seen, you know, faults with the aluminium blocks, and it was just a matter of, you know, center mains getting beaten up and having to line hone them too much. And yeah, that's more so the change, you know. I just want that strength. I want to be able to beat on it all season and not have that problem, you know.
Now, a couple of other things that really come down to the reliability there. This isn't a dyno queen. It's not a street cruiser. It is being beaten, as you say, in competition.
Correct.
Hard, and it's spending a lot of time on the limiter or thereabouts. And you've got that long stroke, you said, 4 1/4 inch?
Yeah, 4 1/8.
Sorry, 4 1/8.
Yeah.
And on top of that, you've also spinning this to fairly high RPM.
Yep.
So that's really one of the things that's going to start hurting engines. High,
yeah,
RPM, a lot of
correct
rotating mass, and a long stroke.
Hence the cast block. You know, yeah, we see with the big stroke in the aluminium blocks, they really start to get a hammering.
And what RPM do you limit this to?
It was 9, now then 87, and now I'm sort of trying to keep it around 85. So rev limit's 87, but I never really want to beat it on that. I would try and have it around 85, you know? Yep.
Now the other thing I want to talk about is, in a previous guise, you're actually running a Procharger for forced induction.
Yep.
Now, have you gone away from that? So interested,
yep,
to get your take on the turbo supercharger and naturally aspirated, sort of where's your head at with that?
So yeah, obviously been a bit spoiled for being able to try everything, but I think for me the Procharger was just a little too cluttered. It's only a small car, it's not big. Had to have a big intercooler in the front. Air temperature was an issue, even with E85. So there was just a few little things which were kind of downsides. I can't put a front sway bar through it. And it just kind of put me off. And then realistically, it just didn't need it. Like, it was excessive.
So that's an aspect that's important to mention. Power isn't everything. So often we see people chasing after more and more power. That's,
yeah,
great to a point. But we're sort of starting to see a situation in Formula D in the US as well as our local drifting in New Zealand that power level's kind of plateaued a little bit. So where do you sort of see the happy place for power to be?
I think it's all tyre related and chassis related. So for our rule book in New Zealand, I think like 850 at the tyre is gnarly. And the dudes that do have genuine 850, you can tell their cars are real grunty. I think up here, 950 a ton, you know, at the wheels, that's sort of what you need for like a 295 40. But Yeah, again, it really does depend, because a lot of people say they've got power and they don't. We all know it.
Yeah, at the end of the day, you can cheat dyno figures, but you can't cheat the performance when you're out on track.
Yeah, exactly.
Now, the other thing, we were talking a little bit off camera there before about the power band that a Procharger delivers. So, I mean, without getting too bogged down in detail, centrifugal superchargers, essentially belt-driven turbo, and you're getting a boost curve that increases with RPM relatively linearly. So you sort of end up with a lot of the power happening at high RPM. How's that affect you for drifting?
It wasn't ideal. It's kind of something which you would need nitrous for, either that or upping the compression and then not turning the blower so hard, so you obviously have a little bit of a punch. And that's what I kind of didn't like about it. I, to be honest, I didn't really spend enough time on it to sort of perfect it, because this was, for me, was kind of the easy way out. And I love the sound of NA, you know. I drove that Procharge thing quite a bit testing, and yeah, it come on boost and it was too much. It was just a wheel speed thing, you know, like, as soon as it would come on, it'd be too much, and then prior to that, you were having to slip the clutch too much. So for me, these things here are just, they're the one, yeah.
All right, in terms of the rest of that engine package, it's one thing making the power, it's another thing keeping it reliable. We talked about that to a degree. The other aspect I want to touch on is the lubrication system, because you've gone all out here as well, as with every aspect of the car. Can you talk us through the lubrication?
So with obviously dry sump system and that, I deal with Bill at Daily Engineering, so obviously he's clued up to the days with oil systems, him and Tony Marsh. So yeah, I run all Daily sump and pump, run a six stage with a vacuum scavenge onto the cover, and then I run dash 16 plus sizes times two back to the tank. So obviously it breathes real well, you know.
So you're actually running two scavenge lines all the way back to the sump?
Returns, yeah. So it's double the size of what the average one is. He did that specially for me. But when he designed all that for me, it was actually for the aluminium blocks. So now we've gone to the cast. Now I actually have to run a vacuum regulator, because if I don't, this thing will pull 30 inches of vacuum.
Let's talk about that, because a lot of people miss this aspect of a dry sump system. It's one thing to make sure you've got the reliable supply of high pressure oil, which is the main driver behind the dry sump. But the other aspect, because you're scavenging all of the oil and combustion blow by out of the crankcase, you can end up pulling a negative pressure or vacuum in there. But it's not a case of more is better, and you do need to manage that. So what happens if you've got too much vacuum in the sump?
You'll probably run pins dry.
So basically sucking the lubrication out of the wrist pins and the pistons?
Yeah, even camshaft. We just had a problem with that. I don't know if it's vacuum related. It could be. So I'm actually going to pull some more out of it. So I would probably say that I'm on the higher side for vacuum for the type of application that I'm in.
Whereabouts are you in that vacuum?
15 inches. So obviously for like an endurance style engine, I think that's quite high, whereas drag racing, probably not at all. I know NASCAR run pretty much perfect vacuum, like 23 or 2 or something.
There's a lot, obviously, that goes into optimizing the engine around that dry sump system.
Well, it makes a lot of power. Like, you can see it'll pick up 30 horsepower just off vacuum. So it's a big thing.
And the other aspect that's nice with the Daily Engineering product is it is integrated. You don't have a lot of work to do mounting an external pump. That's all integrated in the sump.
There's no work to do. I mean, I'll call up Bill and order three sumps at a time. They turn up, they're all the same, they're interchangeable, and it's just how it's how, and that sort of goes back to the whole four rotor thing and the change there. Like, if I wanted to do that for my four rotors, I would have had to do that myself, whereas it takes many people to run a program. So if you can buy something, you know, obviously people like doing it themselves, but generally if you can buy something from someone that's bloody good at what they do, well, it's the way to roll.
No need to reinvent the wheel in that instance.
True story.
All right, so in terms of the rest of the car, obviously we've got that engine, but it needs to be managed somehow, and particularly when you're looking at 850-odd wheel horsepower, you want to make sure that that is all accurate in terms of the ignition timing and the fueling. So what is the electronics package you've got in there?
So I run a GPA M130 MoTeC and PDM30, and then I've got the AFR4 emtron boxes, or can ones, for the Lambas.
All right, so let's break that down for a start. So the M130, that's the ECU and control of the engine itself. So you're running GPA, that's a specific package of basically how it runs the engine.
General package,
So nothing particularly tricky there, off-the-shelf stuff. Now, the interesting thing I did want to touch on there, because we can see them in the exhaust primaries there, you've got individual cylinder lambda sensors. Now, this is something we don't see too often, and you said that's going through the emtron canter lambda controllers?
Yeah. And the reason that I did that is because prior I had the EGTs, and to be honest, like, I know they can be accurate if people use them correctly and stuff, but you know, the probes would constantly get stuck. We're pulling headers off, and then if you have them in too deep, they wouldn't work properly. And there was just some sort of consistency issues there. And then obviously there's nothing better than a lamber and a cylinder, so we went down that route.
Yeah, often we see people using EGT because up until probably a few years ago, it was significantly cheaper than individual cylinder lambda. But in the end, you're using the EGT to kind of decide on what the individual air fuel ratio is. So if you can measure it directly, then great. I'm interested to know what sort of variation are you seeing with this tunnel ram intake system?
It's really due to the butterflies. Like, because they're a progressive butterfly, you'll have four of the butterflies opening over certain cylinders. So that around 5,000 RPM when it's coming on the cam, and then also the throttle blades opening, that's where a lot of the differences is. So cylinder to cylinder, yeah, seeing some pretty big differences actually, not small.
And again, that's so important, because if we're monitoring the air fuel ratio back in the collector, you're getting the average of all the cylinders. So
Sure. That's
not a problem maybe on a street engine, but particularly as you start leaning on the engine, making more more power, you want to make sure that's all on point.
Yeah.
Now, in terms of a driver display, you've got the MoTeC dash in there. What are you using on that? What are you actually physically looking at?
So I actually, I have a talented guy back in New Zealand, Nigel Hoogaveen. He works for Rally Art, so he does all my configs. And far out, I've got everything on that dash. Every scroll, it's got everything. I know what everything's drawing, open circuits, the lot. It's great.
So that's with the display creator, which basically allows you the flexibility to write your own different pages.
Correct.
But the thing as well, and we've seen this from some of your in-car, that's all well and good while you're sitting in line waiting for a run, but realistically you don't have time to look at your PDM current draw.
Correct.
while you're initiating a drift at 200 kilometers an hour. So you're really just looking at sort of gear and shift lights.
Yeah, so basically I have a button that I push, goes into, or I just call it like drift mode or whatever. So then that just gives me my gear that I'm in and rev limit. And then I have those lights, the different colored lights set at different RPMs, so I can, it's almost a little bit like a judge of speed.
Yeah.
And then obviously I have my alarms, but as you know, sometimes if they're a certain type of alarm, I don't really listen, I just keep going. Just try and get rid of them real fast.
Seems like you're pretty much like every driver I know in that instance.
Yeah.
Anytime there's an alarm, as long as the car's going, reset and foot flat.
The only one I look out for is oil. Yeah, if I see oil, she's all over, but anything else, I just, hard up it.
All right, let's cover off the rest of the drivetrain there. So can you tell us what the gearbox is behind this?
So Holinger gearbox, and then all Tilton products forward from there. So I run, this one's got a triple plate carbon in it. Tilton rear mount, bell housing, I got that big starter motor in it. Just tried to stick with one good brand, you know, so then everything's easy, off the shelf, as we know.
Same as everything.
Same, man. And then obviously Holinger look after me, so yeah, I run Hollingers and everything. And obviously with the MoTeC and the closed loop shift cart, I feel that they just match made, you know.
So it's actually something I wanted to get into there. You've obviously just answered the question, was do you use a flat shift or a clutchless shifting? So basically, once you're off the line there, you're just pulling through the gears. So
Correct. Strain
gauge gear lever, so the ECU knows when you're pulling the gear lever back.
Yes. However, I don't use it when I'm actually drifting. So what I actually use it for is just out the box stuff, drag racing starts. I feel like if you were to try and do it under load when the wheels are spinning, you ain't gonna last, you know, you're gonna start wrecking stuff. So I sort of, I clutch shift mid corner, and when I'm rolling on the power in drift. But the lead up to the initiation is all closed loop, yeah.
And still cable throttle on this particular engine?
Yes, it is, yeah. And that's mainly due to throttle body sizing. Like e-throttle stuff's kind of, you're kind of limited to sizing. So something I haven't played with, but maybe in the future.
Probably a little challenging to adapt a drive-by-wire throttle given the intake system you're currently running anyway, so maybe something to look at in the future, as you say. And moving back finally to that differential, what are you running there?
Generic stuff, winters,
pretty much the same as every drift car now.
Yeah, we run a 35 spine axle, and we get the Vasco Max lower shaft made for it, so they're not the off-the-shelf one, but just the generic stuff and wisefab suspension and the rest of it, so
Look, amazing build, Carl. It's a shame that we had to chase you all across to the other side of the world in order to film a tech tour, but we appreciate your time. Thanks for giving us the inside scoop there.
Yeah, likewise, man. Awesome. Cheers.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.